Peter joined KLM in 1973 as a labor analyst in the controller's office. He has held a number of senior positions during his career at KLM. They include head of engineering and maintenance, head of personnel and organization, and head of customer service. He is also a member of the Air Force KLM Supervisory Board, the Kenya Airways Supervisory Board, and a former chairman of IATA. He's currently involved with the Royal Netherlands Air Force Historic Flight Board. Welcome, Peter.
Thank you.
I would also like to welcome Paul Riemens, chairman of the Executive Board and CEO of Air Traffic Control of the Netherlands. Paul started his career at LVNL in 1984 and is an air traffic controller. He became managing director of air traffic management in 2003 and was named chief operating officer of LVNL in 2008. Paul holds a PhD in economics and business administration from VU University in Amsterdam and is chairman of the executive committee of CANSCO, the International Air Traffic Control Organization. Welcome, Paul. Gentlemen, the floor is yours.
Thank you. First of all, thank you for the invitation. Paul and myself, we are really honored to be in this prestigious aviation society, the Wings Club. We are here as a team. And the presentation is therefore a joint presentation. Airline together with air traffic management. And the keywords in our presentation are cooperate and sharing. I told that after the disaster you have seen with Sandy, that our country is 3.5 meters below sea level. And the last real half of it, the last real disaster, we had in 53. So we have excellent qualities and engineers. So if you need some IDs, maybe we can do something. But we all feel sorry for what happened to you, and we also learned from our own staff that it was terrible. The Netherlands is a small country with 15 million people, that's all. And our airport is 3.5 meters below sea level. We have a prominent position in the airline industry. And the question is this right or is this wrong? During the years 50 to 90, KLM and Schiphol Airport grew significantly faster than other airlines and other home bases. In this period, the Dutch airline industry developed her strong international position. Looking back, this strong position is the result of a network of people, committed people, from governments and businesses. By bundling forces and sharing resources, their cooperation became very fruitful. Those days, parties in the airline industry worked with passion, creativity, a strong spirit of enterprise, and a strong mutual trust on one common objective and one shared vision. As such, KLM has been able to develop her worldwide network with Schiphol as hub, and as such, the Dutch airline industry could develop herself. And let's be honest, this model is now copied by the Gulf carriers. Looking back into the Dutch spirit of enterprise pioneering, 1600. Because the Netherlands is a small country, the Dutch have had to fight for many things. And they have always lived with a pioneering spirit needed to enlarge the borders of their small country. The Dutch are powerful in their words and actions. Looking back, we can conclude that our achievements are built on the fundament of the achievements of our ancestors. In order to understand how Dutch airline industry succeeded in building her position, one can look back in Dutch history of sailing and pioneering. During the Golden Age, Dutch spirit of enterprises and pioneering becomes apparent, following the examples of Spanish, British, French, Portuguese explorers. Dutch merchants start sailing over the oceans. Think global, act local. VOC as trading network. New Amsterdam, 1664, founded by the Dutch. Name of the Dutch settlement in the province Nieuw Nederland. The settlement New Amsterdam grew into the city New York. Names like Brooklyn, Breukelen, Harlem, Haarlem, refer to the Dutch presence in the United States. Of course, after that we screwed it up and made a swap with the Antilles. Pieter Stuyvesant, the Dutch governor in 1664, and tomorrow we have the Pieter Stuyvesant Ball, who facilitated between inhabitants of the Dutch settlement and the local authorities. So, cooperation and sharing. The VOC, a trading network, trading to the Far East, was founded in 1602. And the Dutch government ordered cooperation. We did the same for the West Indies, trading with networks, with a combination of commercial contracts, diplomacy, and power. People wonder why the color of KLM is blue. Well, let's look back a little bit in KLM's history and air traffic management. KLM was founded on the 7th of October, 1919. It was founded because we had Dutch colonies in the east and in the west. And it was immediately under the leadership of Albert Plesman. On May 17, 1920, 1 year later, we had a first flight Amsterdam-London. The first year, we had 345 passengers. It included Amsterdam, of course, Hamburg and Copenhagen. The cooperation between Plesman, Fokker, and Dellaert, that was the designer of the airport, would guide Dutch airline industry to a prominent place on the world map. KLM spirit of enterprise, 1929, starting up scheduled service to the Dutch colonies in the Far East. Startup long haul as obligation to the Dutch colony in the East. Thanks to a cooperation with the Dutch post services, the first long haul frequencies to Batavia, that is Jakarta, were started. Amsterdam-Batavia by boat, mailboat, took 2 months, and we did it in 10 days. A long flight, yes. KLM needed 6 aircraft to organize these scheduled services to Batavia, one line. And the departure of the Batavia flight from Amsterdam was connected to the arrival of the London flight. See the first transfer. And that was the basis of the hub and spoke in Amsterdam. We also had a first cooperation en route. That was in Cairo, where we could travel passengers from Cairo to Cape Town with Imperial Airways. All old names. Look at this, the DC-2, the Uiver. We are a small country, but we had rapidly an integrated infrastructure. We were looking not only at Fokker, but also to the United States. In 1935, before World War II, we started to fly with this DC-2. It was introduced in KLM, and we still have the plane. After World War II, we started up the operations with steel aircraft, but there were not sufficient steel aircraft. That's why Plessman traveled to the United States, bought many former DC-3s, but then the military version, and started to fly, and that was, of course, immediately in conflict with Fokker. In 1946, one of the ladies asked me for that, we had the first flight to the United States, and in 2006, we celebrated here in New York 60 years to the Apple. This is a DC-4 Skymaster, no pressurized cabin. But we did it. It was innovative, and it brought more comfort to the passengers. Of course, in 1960, again, American products, the DC-8, and then in 71, we had the 747s. And then in 89, the alliance between KLM and Northwest Airlines. Nobody could believe it, but we did it. And this was the first transatlantic alliance in airline industry. In 1992, we had the first open skies between the United States and the Netherlands. And the United government, US government, prefers to start up as a pilot with a small country. And of course, we are small, not selling planes, not selling military weapons and things like that. So pretty innocent in this respect. The design of a hub and spoke network together with important partners, and we moved from a 3-wave to a 6-wave to a 7-wave. In 04, we merged with Air France because our marketplace was too small with 50 million people. And this was the first based European airline group based on two powerful brands, but also on two powerful hubs, Charles de Gaulle and Amsterdam. Sharing of knowledge, intellectual capital, and infrastructure has always led to improvement of our position and the position of the Netherlands, but also the improvement of safety in the airline industry and the generation of growth. Today, this is KLM, more than 200 planes, 171 destinations from mainland, from mainport Schiphol, well, you can read yourself. And we are also proud to be for the 8th time in a row the number one in the Dow Jones Sustainability Index.
Peter. I worked in the industry for 30 years, and I started as an air traffic controller. And my impression was, when I finally became a controller, that we first and then invented the plane. However, learning my lessons through my career, it became clear that an airline has some more power to steer the world. One of the older photos here, you see an airplane, probably not a passenger, without a tower. Air traffic control is about chess, so you need a tower to play the game. What you see is an old Fokker, and this is where it started. So even an airport was not really visible. The cooperation we had at Schiphol was more some sort of a family. People sitting together was of the Ministry of Transport, the Ministry of Defense, Amsterdam, and KLM. And they worked, let's say, not with the integral processes. They just had a family, shared all the knowledge they had, and they just tried to build a global network. Now, this is the formal message service as part of the Ministry of Transport, where air traffic control had its roots. What you now here see is people that served airline, KLM, in this photo, where they just gave information by radio. There was no radar. They just gave information to pilots on weather conditions, on runway, grass strips, whatever was needed. They called the taxi, and the pilot had to hurry home. So step by step, we of course asked our customer that it's probably better to use a tower and to have oversight of what's happening on an airport. It was by then that the role of air traffic management or air traffic control or let's say the message service changed into a different role. What you saw is that air traffic control or the message service was something where the airline said or the pilot said, listen, there are so many aircraft, you might do something about separation. So we had huge plates of strips just to follow the traffic, and everything that was available was radio. We needed a tower for that, and I think the focus on air traffic control was just to inform the pilots in order to have a safe flight around Schiphol. And it was very concentrated at Schiphol, and every focus was on safety. And next to that, step by step, you saw a focus or a pressure coming from the airline, from KLM, that we needed to get more capacity. Again, a lot of pressure to deliver more capacity. When you saw this growth, this extensive growth, it was again that people in partnerships, in cooperation said, listen, we need to cooperate in order to build a much bigger infrastructure in order to cope with the immense growth. Now, what you here see is the original design in the late 50s, and you recognize some sort of a Dutch mill in it. You see a mill with runways, and the idea behind it was that the concept was that KLM could fly and land and would immediately have the possibility to park the aircraft or the other way around. If you see this design and you currently fly overhead Schiphol, you still recognize this mill and you still see this runway layout, which is from the current concept not really optimal. So again, partnership, cooperation, sharing knowledge gained in Europe, in the world, was necessary to improve our system. After the design, the implementation phase, this is in 67, you still see a combination. We have a new tower, new terminals, new platform, new taxiways. In those days, there were so many taxiways that people even landed on taxiways, making mistakes. So safety was again one of our highest priorities. And it was really strange because we were so excited about the success we had and the growth we had that suddenly there were people against. Now, that could not be the case, of course. People were wrong, so we tried to make them clear that this was necessary for the country. Now, this was quite aggressive because if you see the heritage of that period in the day-to-day negotiation with the surrounding communities and stakeholders that have certain other ideas than the aviation industry, we had to do something in order to improve the relationships and not to fight against them. However, the result of this work and this fight with the surrounding community is a structure with about 167 departure routes and 49 arrival routes. So complex. How complex can you make it? I think the Netherlands is based on our model in negotiating all the time, is a result that counts, and that we just built routes and routes and routes. Not very effective. Now, you here see something special, and this is typical Dutch. I think my role as a CEO or formal controller was talking. Now, that's what we do here. You see a table, the so-called Alders table, former minister, who brings together all the people, the surrounding communities, mayors. You see on the left-hand side Peter Hartman. You see Gerlach Surfonterre, the former CEO of Schiphol. He's over there, by the way. Sorry, Gerlach. We talk for hours, days, nights. It's unbelievable, and it still exists. We were able, and I think the amount of complaints we got is in a million in the last few years, you see that this actually gives you a better embedded infrastructure in the Netherlands. I'm convinced that, again, cooperation with our stakeholders is the way forward to build our infrastructure and to develop our global vision. Again, if you see the hub and spoke system at Schiphol and the pressure not only on capacity, because you saw a shift based on the wave system from KLM, that we had to reinvent air traffic control. Air traffic control was originally separating aircraft. It shifted towards controlling or managing traffic streams. And if you understand an airline with a wave system where connectivity, on-time performance, non-performance costs are of major importance to the success, as air traffic management is sucked into this value network and is focusing on delivering ever and ever again a better service. This is just a photo of our new ops room of 96, where we try to, again, based on cooperation, to build a common integral aviation system in the Netherlands. The current situation, collaborative decision making, you might know the term. All the processes between the airport, KLM, and air traffic management, or LVNL, is integrated in order to focus on that hub and spoke product. This is the current situation. So, go back to sleep, everything is perfect. However, if you look to Europe, and you might have read the papers about Europe, Europe is a bit of a strange country. This is just to give you an impression of the fragmentation in the airspace. This is the most congested part of European airspace. I'm responsible in my European role for designing the airspace in that FIR. And you see a combination of military activities. You see a stream east-west connecting London Heathrow and Frankfurt, and north-south Paris and Amsterdam. There is no room to maneuver. But the European Commission says, listen, Paul, you need to find a solution for that, and we have political power to make you do that. So again, and now the table is even bigger, my role as a formal air traffic controller has now shifted, and I probably end up as a politician. This is Brussels, where all the different ANSPs, states, military entities sit around the table, negotiating, talking, eating and drinking. And it is a very slow process. So your role could also be redefined, because I can, of course, focus on a global or a European level, but you could also follow the value network or the value chain. And if you follow an airline like KLM, it's really funny, because you actually get a payoff much earlier on the investment in hours you make as an ATC organization. Yeah, Peter, what can we expect for the foreseeable future?
That's a good question. One single European sky would lead to 12% lower emissions, 12% lower fuel burn, and a far better product for our passengers. This is finally what you have seen, the infrastructure and everything. It is today. We represent more or less 70% of Schiphol. That means that is easy life for Jos. 70% guaranteed revenues. But this is only possible based on cooperation and sharing, because in the 70%, of course, our friends of Delta are included. Every day with 19 flights. In the winter, only 18, with 19 flights. And be assured, these guys are not coming to Amsterdam because of the weather. It is the beautiful transfer possibilities and the network behind. I show you in a minute. The hub Amsterdam is the number 4. 15 years ago, 20 years ago, we were competing with Copenhagen, with Stockholm, with Switzerland, Geneva, Zurich, with Brussels. Finally, we were the winners, and we are the number 4. We stay the number 4, And we do not have the ambition to be the number one, two or three, because that is crazy. That's Frankfurt and of course Paris and London, with markets 4-5 times larger than the Netherlands. So our strength should be an excellent transfer product. So the hub and spoke concept, and you can see that by far we are the leaders over Spain, over Italy, with far bigger markets. So competition with countries is possible, but what we need are level playing fields. And aviation is infrastructure for the economies in Europe. And you can see that generating 290,000 jobs only in the Netherlands and 26 billion. This is the network. This is the network you won't fly with 200 planes. This is the network we built up over all these years with all our partners. 963 destinations in 181 countries. Just by combining hubs in Europe with hubs in the United States of Delta, with hubs with our Chinese partners, China Southern, China Eastern, Xiamen Airlines, and with our partners in Africa, Kenya Airways. We have a few white spots, and that is still India, but we believe we have a solution for that too. So it is again cooperation and sharing, wealth sharing, but also the sharing of the routes. Again, think global, act local. I would like to highlight a few of these alliances. This was the first, I said, Northwest. Then it became Air France. Then it became Delta. And now we have the joint venture with Delta, Air France, KLM, and Alitalia. And we fly 68,000 seats a day. That is the population of Iceland. That is more than your stadium, the Yankee Stadium. Only, what they told me, 50,000 seats. So in fact, what we did, we created an airline within the airlines with a turnover today of $10 million. I won't reveal the profitability, but be assured that it is profitable. So we are very proud that we are able to do this, and that's the reason why you see every morning on the hub in Amsterdam 19 Delta planes. Position in China. I think KLM brought China on the map from the European perspective. In 2001, only 4 cities. Now we have 9 cities. And we have a few uniques nobody has in Europe. And we are doing this with our SkyTeam partners. I gave the names already, the China Southern, China Eastern, Xiamen Airlines. Next week, they will join SkyTeam. With many, many beyonds out of Xiamen. So the joint ventures, cooperation, that is the way to do it. Number one city was Frankfurt. Number two is Amsterdam. Number three is Moscow. Rather unexpected, but Aeroflot is growing. Number four, Paris. So Air France, KLM is very strong. But number five is Dubai. It's also easy to transfer via Dubai, specifically to the South Americas. So the threats are not these airlines, because we have to respect that these airlines copy what we did in the past and won't make the same mistake we made. But it is all based on one shared vision, from the government up to the handler, airport, air traffic management, and the airline. The same situation we had 20 to 30 years ago. Nowadays, the politicians in Europe take the infrastructure of the traditional network carriers as granted. It is a big mistake that could lead to the disaster in the future. So we are working hard, and I must say, carefully, they are listening. So, What we would like to say, keep a fair level playing field. That is all what we ask. We are not asking for subsidies. Level playing field. So refrain from over-regulation and over-taxation. And that is exactly what's going to happen on a moment that the government sees an economical crisis. The emission trading was a good example. And we are very happy that it is now on ice for a year. And of course, with a threat for Mrs. Hedegaard, that if ICAO is not able to do it, she will be back. Well, it was a joke in our area that this is the only file where Europe was able to bring the Americans, the Chinese, the Russians, and the Indians together. Fighting this crazy idea of emission trading the way she wanted to introduce. And of course, we are not environmental monsters in aviation. We care. And that's why we were supporters also under the IATA flag for a global system. What you can see here is all the impacts and all the innovations we did. Let me give you a few other examples. Airlines, airports, and air traffic management systems should align. We did a lot with dialogues with partners. We worked hard on sustainability. We did biofuel flights together with our friends from General Electric and Boeing, because you needed certification, not only to Paris, but also to Rio. We did it already on a 777. And social media. And I hope you have seen already some experiences, the way we handle social media. And we are very proud also to have with the World Wide Fund a relation with aviation. This is the future, we believe. The future from social media. We started in November 2010. November 10 was a little bit later than the ash cloud. And you remember the ash cloud, and Paul just showed the room in Brussels, and they made more ash out of it. The future of our aviation industry. It's for sure that we will see growth. In the bottom left, you can see a multiple of more or less 3 in the revenue passenger kilometers. That is the good news. But the bad news is that the real growth is not on the North Atlantic. It will come from streams north to South America, from China straight into Africa, within China, within the Southeast and over the Pacifics. That's why you need partners. That's why we can share the competences. We can share the lessons we learned, not only in the airline, but also in traffic management. And I think that I have to thank Paul for the efforts he did already in the single European sky. On the other hand, it is also frustrating to know that we have that subject already on the European agenda for almost 55 years. But we are making small progress.
Well, if you're already a team player, what else could you do? Air traffic management is to a certain level in the Netherlands and Europe at a level where you say, okay, this is acceptable and good enough. So what else could you do? And if you see what's globally happening, and in my role as a chairman of CANSO, I see in the different regions a variety of air traffic management organizations, ANSPs as called. For instance, if you compare Europe to China, it's a state-embedded, sometimes a military ANSP or a military entity delivering the service. Talking to customers is not very easy. If you look in Africa, safety is always an issue. In our role, we have to reinvent air traffic management again, because what could be our added value to the network of aviation organization in the Netherlands. Learning from the open skies with America, and we look at what we could do. We follow KLM by saying, what could we do to improve that global network from a different angle? You see all kinds of alliances between airlines, but what could you do with air traffic management? The need in the Middle East, but also in China or in Africa, is immense. The export of knowledge, which we build up in the last 5 or 6 decades, could be exported in order to build sustainable connections with these bigger hubs. And it's therefore that if you look to the connection between Amsterdam and Beijing, analyzing the needs of the carriers between those cities, we said, listen, couldn't be a step forward that we look, for instance, in the Netherlands, where we have AXO, a supplier of paint for all kind of industries. And you see they build a plant in Beijing, that the amount of traffic between Beijing and Amsterdam is immense. Could you, with an exchange with the Chinese and the Netherlands, try to bring a bridge? A bridge that is sustainable into the future, and that you try to export all kind of knowledge, again, partnership, between China and the Netherlands, not only on air traffic management, but also on the supplier side. Whatever is needed to build a sustainable connection. And I therefore think that, and if you see the date, 2025, Peter will be here again, he probably doesn't know, in order to celebrate the Chinese-Dutch industry bridge, where a huge amount of organizations fill in a value network. So my role as LVNL and on my global role, I'm going to work on that network. It gives me a lot of work for the next coming 10 years. But I know that Peter is already thinking about even beyond that. So my question is, Peter, what's next?
Yeah, left away. I will show you, and this is not faked. This is reality. We stepped in Space Experience Company. And this plane, or this vehicle, I do not know, this spaceship, will fly in 14. This is in competition what Richard Bransfield is doing. But it is built in the United States. We have already the engine. We have already the vehicle. And what we have seen on the flights to Batavia in the 20s will happen with this experience. And that is what we expect. That is the good news. The bad news, again, is that I see that it is not a tower, but a kind of a satellite with the logo of the monopolist, the air traffic management organization. So, Paul, I do not know what you want with that little satellite.
Well, if you see, this is just the reinvention of a tower, just to keep our monopoly, because in the end, I want to keep my monopoly. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mart.
Been a great pleasure to have both of you with us, and on behalf of the board of the Wings Club, I'd like to present to Paul and to Peter mementos of this time with us today, and it reads, in grateful appreciation for your presentation at the Aviation Leaders Series of the Wings Club, New York City, November 2012. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.